This is the first of a multi-part series exploring the use of a labscope in automotive diagnostics. In this first video, we'll start with an historical introduction, followed by a demonstration of how to do a very fast indirect compression test using a picoscope. Good morning. Well, most of the people who watch my channel started fixing cars decades ago, and in those days, most of us were able to get by with a test light, a multimeter, and a healthy dose of common sense. Of course, in 1996, things changed when the OBD2 regulations came into effect. That required all manufacturers to give generic access to a diagnostic port for evaluation of emission control. Importantly, most companies used the same port for technical evaluation of other devices. Well, from there, a whole family of scanners was born. The cheap ones, like this one here by Autel, are read-only, sometimes faster, and if I just need to erase a code, I still use one of these. The more expensive scanners are slower, but they show live data with more codes and more detail. This one here is by Auto Ingenuity. It's the one I've been using, although it has its own limitations. I find it a little bit buggy. The best high-level scanners have more control capability, allowing you to use the PCM to turn devices on and off for diagnostic purposes. That's hard to bundle in a generic package, and it's a constantly shifting industry, and so IM devices need expensive and regular updating. Well, any mechanic will tell you, even a high-level scan tool rarely tells the whole story, and the algorithm of just replacing a part pointed out by the scan tool is often expensive and misdirected. This is where DIY efforts seriously derail. So even if you have a diagnostic trouble code, the experienced techs remember to verify their diagnosis. I find it so elegant to see how often this can be done with those classic old test tools, a test light or a multimeter, or in this case, a power probe. But remember that some problems can be completely invisible to the PCM. And as cars become increasingly complex, we need to follow that with increasing complexity of diagnostic tools to keep up with this DIY automotive game. The bulky analog oscilloscopes of a past generation have now evolved into digital devices like this one, capable of storing and manipulating data. This little one has been my oscilloscope over the last few years, and it serves me well for electronics diagnosis. Ultimately, these things are simply a way of plotting measured voltage against time, and most have multiple channels to compare one with the other. But often in automotive diagnostics, you need peripheral devices like this low amp current probe and this inductive pipup to measure what you need to know, and a generic oscilloscope by itself just isn't enough. Well, most of you guys know that to do a compression test in a V8 takes about an hour. I'm going to show you a very similar test that gives you almost as good a data in about 10 minutes using the Pico. To understand how current draw for a starter motor can be used to produce a relative compression test, you need to understand three simple concepts. When a DC series motor meets an increase in torsional resistance, it overcomes that resistance by generating more torque, and it gets energy for that torque by consuming more current. So you can estimate torque by looking at instantaneous current draw. Now, if you consider one cylinder in a four-stroke engine, you'll realize that passive resistance to crankshaft rotation occurs at a very narrow phase of the engine cycle, at the end of the compression phase, when both valves are closed and the piston is moving upward. By comparison, resistance from other phases in the cycle consume very little, if any, energy. Now remember that all multi-cylinder engines are designed to stagger their current cycles for smoother function. This means that although starter motor current draw represents the sum of all sources of resistance, at any moment, the bulk of that resistance is coming from a single cylinder. This means that if you plot starter motor current draw against time, you'll get a series of humps, the height of each hump being relatively proportional to the compression of that single cylinder. We're going to do this test with a starter motor with the car off, but we don't want the car starting when we turn the starter motor over. So I'm going to starve the throttle body of fuel by pulling out the fuel pump relay now. Now at the moment the car is running, as I pull out the fuel pump relay, it's going to be starved for gas, and now there's no fuel and we're not going to start when we turn the starter motor over. Now I'm going to turn the vehicle off and we'll get started with the test. Okay, I've got the Pico loaded. Let me show you this. They've got some presets that make things really slick here. I'm going to go to automotive, charging and starting, and I want to do a relative compression test. And since they're from the UK, we use petrol. And watch what happens here. This loads up the presets so that the presets are set, and it gives you an example waveform. But look what's happening here. If you've got an active website or a Wi-Fi connection, it directs you right to a page which just walks you through how to do this test, so you don't need to keep consulting the manual to do it. But let me show you how we'll do this. This is an example waveform. It's not the waveform I've set up. So my next step is I need to hook up my sensors. All right, this is the 2000 amp Pico current clamp, and it's got a standard BNC connector. We'll connect that to channel A. And then I'm going to set it at 2000 amps. You can see it's turned on. And then I'm going to zero by pressing that button. Now I'm going to put it on. Now it's directional, the positive current going that way. And so it's easy enough to hook up to the positive current lead here. If the positive is inaccessible, you can use the negative, because the reality is the starter motor takes so much juice that it dominates any other electrical consumption. We're back at the screen, and now we need to tell the software what probe we're using. It's not the 600 amp current clamp, it's the 2000. So we'll go down here, and I've got it set at 2000 amp mode there. If we're using a 10 to 1 attenuator, you click that in as well. So now it's we've told it what we're using for that channel. Okay, the next step is to put on an inductive pickup wire into one of the plug wires. These things come with the ground. You put the ground on first, and then you put it on one of the plug wires. Now it doesn't matter which wire, but you don't want to know which one it is. This is plug number 2, and I'm going to hook this up to channel B of the Pico. Now the reason we're doing this is so when we analyze the curve later, we'll be able to identify which cylinder is responsible for which hump of the curve. I'll show you that later. Now to set up channel B, I've chosen the secondary igniter. This one right here, secondary ignition probe inverted. And make sure you turn it on. And I've chosen to trigger with none so that the screens roll through and I can pick out the best one later. Okay, we've got everything hooked up pretty well. Now make sure the fan belt's not going to catch any wires, nothing's going to fall over when we bump the motor over. Let's turn it over now and see what we see. And first turn the unit off. Now, it stopped recording, and it's recorded 23 screens. And so now I'm going to scroll back one screen at a time and just look for what I was recording. And there's a good screen right there. The error is where we started. So this looks like the best one right here. We can manipulate it as we want. You can see that my current draw is pretty good right here. And all of the humps look symmetrical and equal. And so on a general basis, this test has passed. You can see the spikes from cylinder number 2. There's one right there, and there's one right there. And so let's print this out, and we'll spend a bit more time discussing which cylinder is responsible for which hump here. Now, to save it, we go File. I'll save. And I'm not going to put, let's see, we'll do the recent vehicle as the Dodge Ram. And I'll save it there. All right, well, the nice thing about having the file up on a PC like this is that you can move it around and make it easier to see. And so I can move the whole scale up this way without changing the actual values. And I can actually even measure the values with this slider here. And so our readings are up here. This is looks like the bottom amp draw is about 98 amps. And if we look up here, the peak draw at the top is about 163 amps at the top. But more importantly, each of these humps looks about the same. So this one's a little bit smaller, but really not dramatically so. And so when you do a compression test in the manual way, in the usual way, you look for one cylinder to be way out of the ordinary compared to all the others. And if you do, then you identify that cylinder as having bad compression. On the positive side, we've done this test much more quickly, but on the negative side, we don't have actual readings with which to compare. Now, if you do have one cylinder that's a little bit out of the ordinary, then it's worthwhile pursuing which cylinder is that. So we've got one that's a little bit smaller here. You can see it's not just artifact because it's present in that one as well. Which cylinder is responsible for this hump? Well, we know that the spark plugs are for cylinder number 2, fired here and here. And these are 8 cylinders. And so let's do a little arithmetic to find out which cylinder is this one here. All right, my goal is to show you which part of the compression cycle we're dealing with. And to start that out, we're going to start with cylinder number 2, which is the spark plug fires here and here. And as you know, it's 2 full revolutions of the crankshaft for every spark of one cylinder. And so, as you recall from the compression cycle, there are 4 phases to it. And as my friend Eric O says, the best way to remember that is suck, squeeze, bang, blow. And this one fires just a little bit before top dead center of the bang phase. And so we're just going to move it here like so, and then put 4 little dots to outline. Each of those. All right. Now let's draw some lines to divide that up. All right, well, I went to the dealer's manual, and this is the firing order for this engine. 2, 1, 8, 4, 3, 6, 5, 7. So if we make the assumption that the bang is at the peak of the compression cycle, then this should be cycle number 2, this cylinder number 2. 2, 1, 8, 4, 3, 6, 5, 7. Then we start again with 2. And so the one that I find particularly interesting is this one. It's pretty close, but its compression seemed a little bit less than all the others. Let's pull the plug out on cylinder number 4 and have a look at that plug. And let's do the compression test with cylinder number 4, with plug number 4 completely removed, so there'd be no compression there. Let's see what the curve looks like then. Now, while we've got plug number 4 out, let's have a look at this. Now, I'm not sure if you can appreciate this with the camera, but there's an interesting fragment right there that's crossing the boundary between the center pole and the electrode on the outside. It's just in this one pole here. All right, well, we're going to do the same test. This time the plug is out of number 4, cylinder number 4, and we'll see what contribution 4 makes to the curve. I don't like to do this for a long time, but a brief episode with the fuel pump relay pulled out shouldn't be a big issue. And here are the curves back to back. This is the curve with cylinder number 4, the plug for cylinder 4 removed. It would have been right there. And you can see it lines up perfectly with the marker point for cylinder number 2 here. 2, 1, 8, and then a blank. 3, 6, 5, 7. And so we verified that, yes, indeed, this is the pressure point for cycle number 2. We've lined them all up, and we've taken plug number 4 out. I'll be interested to see whether replacing and that plug number 4 makes a difference in terms of changing the slope of the curve.
Well, I wouldn't expect replacing a fouled plug to make a difference in terms of compression. Indeed, the compression cycle is exactly the same with the new plug in place. That said, that 4 cylinder is significantly abnormal, and we're going to explore that in more detail with secondary ignition waveforms. See, if you like this video, I think you're going to like the next one as well. It's on secondary waveform analysis using a labscope to help with DIY diagnostics. Thanks for watching.